Welcome. In this presentation, I'm going to talk about rasterization-based rendering, which is one of the major approaches in image synthesis. Here we see the outline of the lecture. I start with some introductory comments where I illustrate the concept of rasterization-based rendering. I also discuss some terms that I'm going to use throughout the presentation. After the discussion of the context, I will introduce the main stages of rasterization-based rendering. We will see that the rendering process is organized in four main stages, namely vertex processing, rasterization, fragment processing, and the frame buffer update. These stages will be discussed in more detail. When we generate an image, we estimate which scene element is visible at which sensor position, and we compute the light transport from a visible scene element to its projected position on the sensor plane. We have already discussed options to solve both problems. We have seen how to use raycasting to resolve the visibility problem, and I have introduced the Phong illumination model to compute the reflected light from surfaces towards the sensor. In raycasting, here illustrated on the left-hand side, we cast rays into the scene and we compute intersections of these rays with the scene elements. If a ray intersects the scene, for instance, at positions P1 and P2, then we know that the respective surface patches of the scene are projected onto position Q on the sensor plane. Finally, we choose the closest intersection because all other intersections are occluded and not visible at the sensor. In rasterization-based rendering or in a rasterizer, illustrated on the right-hand side, we solve the same problem by explicitly projecting all scene elements onto the sensor plane. In the example, scene elements at positions P1 and P2 would be transformed to their projected position Q, and then finally we would estimate that P2 is occluded by P1 and only P1 is visible at position Q. Today I will talk about a rendering concept that uses this idea. The concept is referred to as rasterization-based rendering or just rasterization. It is typically implemented in the so-called rendering pipeline, and one of the core characteristics of the concept is that it transforms all scene elements onto the sensor plane. As the name suggests, rasterization-based renderers employ a rasterization process. This is indicated here in the slide. Rasterization refers to the process of estimating the pixel positions in the sensor plane that are covered by a projected scene element. This is illustrated here for a triangle and a line segment. We have a triangle that is specified by three vertices. Vertices are just 3D positions. On the right-hand side, we see the projected triangle in the sensor or image plane. Now the gray pixel areas approximately represent the projected triangle, and rasterization actually estimates this set of pixel positions. The same idea is illustrated for a line segment. The line segment is specified by two vertices, and the gray pixel areas in the image plane approximately represent the projected line segment. Again, the rasterization process estimates the respective pixel positions. The rasterization of scene elements is motivated by the fact that visibility and light transport can be efficiently implemented on a per pixel basis. For instance, if two scene elements share the same pixel position, we can easily estimate which element is closer to the viewer and then compute the light transport for the visible scene element at that pixel position. The idea of the visibility test after rasterizing a primitive is outlined here in this slide. We have two triangles whose projections partially overlap. When we rasterize the projected triangles in the image plane, we get pixel positions that are only affected by the gray triangle, we get pixel positions that are only affected by the green triangle, but we also get pixel positions that represent both the gray and the green triangle. Now for these pixel positions, where more than one scene element is potentially visible, we compare the distances or depth values of the scene elements to the viewer. And this test can be efficiently implemented at pixel positions. The rasterization of scene elements is typically implemented in clip space, which means the rasterization process assumes that the scene is represented in a canonical view volume. This is illustrated here in 2D with a 1D image plane on the left-hand side of the square that shows the canonical view volume. Conceptually, the rasterization process considers parallel viewing rays and estimates the illustrated intersections. These intersections indicate which pixel positions are affected or covered by which surface patch of the scene. If more than one surface patch covers the same pixel position, we choose the surface patch closest to the viewer. As we work in the canonical view volume, these processes can be implemented very efficiently on a per pixel basis. Instead of actually using viewing rays, the intersections can be easily estimated by an orthogonal projection of all seen elements onto the sensor plane. The rasterization process that I've discussed in the previous slides is embedded into a complete rendering approach. Prior to the rasterization, the scene is set up and transformed into clip space. After the rasterization, visibility is resolved and the light transport is computed to get the image. The entire rendering process is referred to as rendering pipeline or rasterization-based rendering or just rasterization. The term rendering pipeline actually refers to a special realization or implementation of a rasterization-based renderer. And the term rasterization is used for both the actual rasterization of scene elements or the entire rendering process. The embedding of rasterization in a rasterization-based renderer is illustrated here in this slide. We start with our objects in local space. When building the scene that we would like to render, we apply the model transform, the inverse view transform, and the projection transform to all objects. After these transformations, our objects are in the canonical view volume. Culling removes all objects outside the view volume, and clipping removes parts of objects outside the view volume. Then the rasterization is performed, which means that we estimate the pixel positions that are covered by the projected objects. If more than one surface patch is projected onto a pixel position, we resolve visibility by choosing the surface patch that is closest to the viewer. This is done at all pixel positions. Once we know which surfaces are visible at which sensor position, we compute the respective light transport from the scene elements towards the sensor. This shading process is illustrated here with red, yellow, and blue surface patches. In order to compute the light transport or the pixel color, the Phong illumination model is typically used. After the shading process, we have our final image, which is a 1D array here in this illustration. Again, rasterization is actually just the process of estimating the pixel positions that are covered by the projected objects. Often, however, the term rasterization is also used for the entire rendering approach. Now I'd like to introduce some terms that I'm going to use throughout the presentation. First of all, object surfaces are sampled at positions. These positions are referred to as vertices. So a vertex has a position and also other attributes, for instance, the reflectance of the surface at that position. Vertices form primitives. In the illustration, two vertices form a line segment. In 3D, three vertices typically form triangles, and these triangles or primitives or faces approximately represent the object surface. Now the primitives are projected onto the sensor and the rasterization process estimates the pixel positions that are covered by a projected primitive. For each of these pixel positions, a fragment is generated. Here in this illustration, each black line segment represents a fragment. Fragments can be seen as a small data structure that stores attributes. Fragments have a pixel position, they have a distance to the sensor, and they can have a color. Fragments are also referred to as pixel candidates. This is due to the fact that fragments do not necessarily contribute to the final image. Instead, fragments can also be discarded, as illustrated in the third image. If we have more than one fragment with the same pixel position, we discard occluded fragments and only keep the fragment that is closest to the sensor. For the remaining fragments, we can compute the reflected light towards the sensor, for instance with the Phong illumination model. The resulting color is stored at a fragment, as indicated here with green, blue, and yellow lines. Finally, the remaining fragments are used to update the frame buffer. The frame buffer is a 2D array that consists of pixels. Each pixel is characterized by attributes. A pixel has a position, it can store a color and also other quantities such as depth values. The pixel colors in the frame buffer form our final image. And the color of a pixel is updated by using information from a fragment at the position of the pixel. So fragments and pixels are different entities. Fragments can be seen as small surface patches that approximately represent the surfaces of objects. Fragments are generated in the rasterization process. Pixels, on the other hand, are elements of the two-dimensional frame buffer. They store attributes, and one of these attributes is color. The colors of all pixels represent our rendering result, the final image. Here we have another illustration of the introduced terms. We start with a triangle, a face or a primitive that is formed by three vertices. These vertices have positions and other attributes. Here, the vertices store the color of the primitive. Now the rasterizer estimates the set of pixel positions in the image that are covered by the projected primitive. For each of these pixel positions, a fragment is generated. So each green square indicates a fragment, and the color is an attribute stored per fragment. The fragments are processed, and here in this example, the color attributes of all fragments are used to update the color of a pixel in the frame buffer. So we have some green pixels in our frame buffer. Now we have a second triangle. Again, the projected triangle is rasterized and a set of fragments is generated. Here the color of the fragments is gray. In this example, the projections of the gray and the green triangle overlap. So at some pixel positions, we generate a second fragment. In this case, we compare the distances of the two fragments per pixel position. Occluded fragments are discarded and only attributes of visible fragments are used to update the frame buffer. In the example, some fragments of the gray triangle are discarded as they are occluded by the green triangle. The remaining fragments contribute to the frame buffer. Here I'd just like to illustrate vertices, fragments and pixels. In the following, I will discuss more details on how to process vertices and fragments and also how to update pixel information. That's it about the context. I've introduced the idea of rasterization and rasterization-based rendering. And I've discussed terms such as primitive, vertex, fragment, pixel, and frame buffer. Now I will give an overview of the main stages of a rasterization-based renderer, which are vertex processing, rasterization, and fragment processing. After giving the overview, I will discuss these stages in more detail. But first, we start with the overview. Rasterization-based renderers are generally implemented in the so-called rendering pipeline, and the design of this pipeline is largely motivated by parallelism. So in the first main stage of the rendering pipeline, vertices are processed. The input of this stage is a set of vertices, and the output of this stage is also a set of vertices. The main purpose of this stage is the realization of vertex transformations, such as model transform, inverse view transform, and projection transform. So the vertex stage processes the positions of vertices. However, the stage can also process other attributes such as color or texture coordinates of vertices. For instance, the Phong illumination model can be evaluated at vertices to compute a color. Generally, all computations at the vertices are local. They just use and adapt attributes at individual vertices. That's why all computations in the vertex stage are easily parallelizable. The second main stage of the rendering pipeline performs the rasterization of primitives. It gets transformed vertices from the vertex stage and combines the vertices with connectivity information. This means we know which primitive is formed by which vertices. Connectivity information is also referred to as topology. As output, the rasterization stage produces fragments. First, vertices and connectivity information are combined to get the primitives, which is referred to as primitive assembly. Then the primitives are rasterized. The rasterization process estimates all pixel positions that are covered by the projected primitives, and for each respective pixel position, a fragment is generated. In the last step of the rasterization stage, the attributes at fragments are either set or interpolated. For instance, if colors are known as the three vertices of a triangle, then these colors could be transferred to all fragments of the triangle. One attribute that is definitely interpolated is the depth value, the distance to the sensor. After the vertex processing stage, the depth values are known at vertices of a primitive, and in the rasterization stage, these depth values are interpolated to the respective fragments of a primitive. The depth values are typically employed for the visibility test of a fragment. In addition to depth value and color, other attributes can also be interpolated from vertices to fragments, for instance, texture coordinates, whose usage will be explained later in the presentation. The next stage processes fragments. It gets fragments from the rasterization process, it processes these fragments, and it results in a set of fragments. The fragment processing stage processes the attributes of fragments, and the stage also performs tests on fragments. For instance, it can be tested whether a fragment occludes another one, and then the occluded fragment can be discarded. The remaining fragments with their processed attributes are used to update the frame buffer. So this stage gets a set of fragments and results in frame buffer attributes. So if we have a fragment with some pixel position, color, and depth value, then the color of the fragment can be used to set the color of the respective pixel in the frame buffer with the same pixel position. The depth value of a fragment is also typically stored in the frame buffer at the position of the fragment. Again, the implementation of a rasterization-based renderer and the so-called rendering pipeline is largely motivated by parallelism. In the fragment processing stage, for instance, all fragments are processed independently from each other, so their processing can be fully parallelized. Here we see an illustration of the main stages of the rendering pipeline. The first stage just works on vertices and their attributes. The vertices are transformed and attributes can be set or computed. Here the colors indicate that the Phong illumination model could be evaluated at vertices if all required information is available. The second stage starts with the primitive assembly. Basically, we combine the transformed vertices with the information which vertices belong to which primitive. After the primitive assembly, we have a set of primitives, for instance, triangles or line segments. These primitives are now rasterized. The rasterizer estimates the set of pixel positions that approximately represent a projected primitive. So for each square in this illustration, a fragment is generated. The attributes of these fragments are either set or interpolated from known attributes at the respective vertices. This is indicated here for the color. So vertex colors are interpolated to the fragments. Other attributes, in particular depth values, are interpolated to the fragments as well. Then fragment attributes are further processed and tests are performed in order to decide whether a fragment should contribute to the frame buffer or whether it should be discarded. The remaining fragments are used to update the frame buffer. So in particular, the color and the depth value of a remaining fragment are used to update the color and the depth value of a pixel in the frame buffer at the position of the fragment. The organization of a rasterization-based renderer within the stages that I have discussed is motivated by computational efficiency. First, vertices are independently processed, later individual fragments are processed independently. The organization of the stages within the so-called rendering pipeline made it easy and appropriate to realize the rendering concept on hardware in order to accelerate the computations. And OpenGL, DirectX, or Vulkan are software interfaces to hardware implementations of the rendering pipeline. When using any of the software interfaces, the processing of the vertices and the fragments that will be performed on graphics processing units, GPUs, can be specified by the user. This is indicated here as vertex shader and fragment shader in the illustration. Here the term shader is not related to shading, to the computation of a color, but instead it just refers to a program. So a vertex shader states how to process vertices and a fragment shader states how to process fragments. In addition to the processing of vertices and fragments, further actions can be specified by a user. For instance, a tessellation shader can be used to generate primitives and a geometry shader can be used to adapt the scene geometry. Some functionality, for instance the primitive assembly and the rasterization, are fixed and cannot be specified or adapted by the user. You can also see that vertex data is the input of the vertex shader and the processed vertex data together with the connectivity information is the input for the primitive assembly. In addition to vertex and connectivity data, the rendering pipeline can also process additional data that is generally referred to as texture data. This can be basically anything. For instance, it can be an array of material colors that is used in any of the rendering stages. GPUs are not only used to render images. Instead, GPUs can also perform so-called general-purpose computations. That's why the software interface is also allowed to specify general compute shaders that are executed on a GPU. That's it about the overview of the rendering pipeline. Now we start to look into some more details of the individual stages, and first I will discuss the vertex processing stage. The main task of the vertex processing stage is the realization of the scene setup. Objects are placed into the world coordinate system with the model matrix MI. The camera setup in the world coordinate system is described by the view matrix V, and the internal camera parameters are encoded in the projection matrix P. In this case, the vertex state transforms all vertices p to new positions p prime by first applying the model transform, followed by the inverse view transform and the projection transform. After these transformations, all potentially visible vertices are inside the canonical view volume. All vertices outside the canonical view volume are definitely not visible in the final image. In the context of hardware-supported rendering, the vertex transformations are particularly important as GPU rasterizers generally assume that all vertices are in clip space. The fixed functionality within the rasterization stage performs culling and clipping, so only vertices inside the canonical view volume are considered in the subsequent processes. Therefore, it is the responsibility of the vertex processing stage to ensure that all relevant vertices are inside the canonical view volume. Now a user has two options to set up a scene. First, model transforms can be specified for each object, and the view and the projection transform are specified for the camera. This is elegant and also versatile. Alternatively, the scene geometry can also be directly specified in the canonical view volume. Then no transformations have to be performed. This option, however, is generally not advisable, as the realization of complex spatial relations among objects and specific camera settings are cumbersome, if not impossible. Vertices have attributes. In particular, they are characterized by a position. This position can be considered in various coordinate systems. In the beginning, this position is defined in the local coordinate system, and after applying model, inverse view, and projection transform, we get the position in clip or NDC space. If you have a vertex position in NDC space, then the Z component is referred to as depth value. This value represents the distance of a vertex in the canonical view volume to the camera plane. In addition to a position, vertices can have other attributes. It is, for instance, possible to set or to compute a color at a vertex in the vertex stage. If surface normal, light, and material properties are available at the surface, then the Phong model could be computed. Colors are typically represented with three components, red, green, and blue. As vectors often consist of four components in hardware-accelerated implementations, the three color components are typically combined with a fourth component, the so-called alpha value R. It is very popular to use the alpha value in the rendering of semi-transparent surfaces. A small value indicates that the vertex belongs to a transparent surface, a large value indicates an opaque surface. In order to realize semi-transparent surfaces, it's not sufficient to just set the alpha value. Instead, the processing of the alpha value has to be specified in the fragment processing or in the frame buffer update in order to realize the desired effect. Alternatively, the alpha value can also be used for other purposes. It is just a degree of freedom that we can specify together with the three color components of a vertex. But again, typically the alpha value is used in the context of transparent surfaces. Another attribute that I'd like to mention here are the texture coordinates. Texture coordinates are just additional data that can be used in the rendering process. This data can be a scalar value, or a 1D, or 2D, or 3D array. Textures can be used when processing vertices and fragments, and in this process, the texture coordinates are used to look up data from textures. If we store the texture coordinates UV at a vertex, then we can look up information from a 2D texture with the coordinates UV, and we can use the respective texture data in the processing of the vertex. This concept will be explained in more detail later in the presentation. The mapping of texture coordinates to vertices is either part of the scene modeling process, or the coordinates are procedurally computed in the vertex stage. That's it about the vertex processing stage. This stage processes vertex attributes. In particular, positions are transformed to clip or NDC space, and for each vertex in NDC space, its depth value, the distance to the viewer, is known. Additionally, other attributes such as color or texture coordinates can be optionally defined or computed. Now we look into some aspects of the rasterization stage. The main purpose of the rasterization stage is the rasterization of the projected scene geometry. From the vertex processing stage, we get the vertex positions of the projected geometry, and we now combine the vertices with the topology information. This provides us with a set of primitives, for instance, line segments and triangles, that can be rasterized. For each primitive, the rasterizer estimates a set of pixel positions that approximately represent the primitive, and for each of these pixel positions, a fragment is generated. Fragments are characterized by a pixel position, and they also carry attributes such as color, depth, or texture coordinates. If these attributes are available at the vertices of a primitive, they are typically transferred to the fragments. In particular, the depth value is interpolated from vertices to fragments. This is important for the visibility test that is performed on a per pixel basis. Texture coordinates are also typically interpolated, and for color values, there exist different options. For instance, the color of one vertex could be used as the color of all fragments of a primitive, which would be flat shading. Alternatively, the colors can be linearly interpolated from vertices to fragments, which would correspond to Gouraud shading. Culling and clipping is also typically realized within the rasterization stage, but not discussed in this presentation. In the following, I focus on the rasterization of line segments and triangles, and I discuss some details in terms of interpolating the attributes. To illustrate the rasterization concept, we start with a line segment. A line segment is specified by two vertices with positions PB and PE. These 2D positions are the pixel positions of the projected vertices of the line segment. The image illustrates the positions of the vertices PB and PE, and now the goal of the rasterizer is to estimate the yellow pixel positions that approximately represent the line segment from PB to PE. The algorithm that we look at in order to compute the discretized line representation is mainly motivated by efficiency. In the beginning, the algorithm is defined for line segments with slopes between 0 and 1, but it can easily be generalized to arbitrary line segments by employing symmetries. Now, when we know that the slope of a line segment is between 0 and 1, we can realize a very simple algorithm to get a spatial discretization of the line segment. The first fragment is generated at PB with components X, B, and YB. In the following, we generate exactly one fragment for each X value between XB and XE. So based on the fragment at XB, YB, we generate the next fragment with an X value of XB plus 1. And for the Y component, we decide whether to keep it constant or whether to increment it by 1. We just have these two options as the slope of the line segment is between 0 and 1. So for each new fragment, we increment the X value of the previous fragment by 1, and the Y component is either incremented by 1 or remains unchanged. When we reach PE, the algorithm is terminated. So in general, we have a current fragment at pixel position XI, YI, and we need a procedure to decide whether to choose XI plus 1, YI, or XI plus 1, YI plus 1 as the next fragment. And this procedure is realized in the so-called Bresenham line algorithm. The Bresenham line algorithm employs an implicit representation of the line segment. The function f of XY is 0, if a position xy is on the line. The line parameters a, b, c are computed from the two endpoints of the line segment pb and pe. As illustrated in the illustration, the function f has an interesting property. It cannot only be evaluated for positions on the line, but it can be computed for arbitrary positions xy. If xy is on the line, f is 0. If xy is above the line, f is negative. If xy is below the line, f is positive. So the line generates two half spaces indicated here with the yellow and blue. By evaluating the sine of the function f for a given position xy, we can find out whether a position is below, above, or on the line. This property is used to find the next fragment based on a given fragment. The yellow circle represents our current fragment at position xi, yi. Now the Bresenham algorithm decides whether to move east or northeast. East means that our next fragment would be xi plus 1 yi. Northeast means that our next fragment would be xi plus 1 yi plus 1. In order to decide whether east or northeast is closer to the line, we evaluate the line function f at the position xi plus 1 yi plus 0.5, which is the midpoint between east and northeast. By looking at the sine of f at the midpoint, we know whether the midpoint is below or above the line. In the illustration, f is positive at the midpoint, which means that the midpoint is below the line. If the midpoint is below the line, then the line is closer to northeast, which means that we choose northeast as our next fragment. If f would be negative, then we know that the midpoint is above the line and the line is closer to east. In this case, we would choose east as the next fragment. So we start with a fragment at xi, yi. Then we evaluate the line function f at the midpoint between east and northeast, which are the two candidates for the next fragment. And finally, we choose east or northeast as the next fragment based on the sine of f at the midpoint. At first sight, it seems to be a little involved to evaluate the function f for each fragment of the line segment. In the implementation, however, it turns out that f can be efficiently updated by adding a constant offset to a previously evaluated value of f. This implementation aspect is discussed on this slide. We assume that we have evaluated our function f at the position xi plus 1, yi plus 0.5. We refer to this value as di. Now we are interested in an incremental update from di to di plus 1, which means we search for the difference between di and di plus 1. We have two cases. If di is positive, then we move northeast and the next midpoint would be xi plus 2, yi plus 1 plus 0.5. If di is negative, then we move east and the next midpoint is xi plus 2, yi plus 0.5. Before we look at the two cases, I'd like to briefly discuss the parameters a, b, c of our line equation f. It turns out that a is equal to delta y, which is the difference of the y components of the end and the start point of the line segment. The parameter b is equal to minus delta x, which is the x component of that difference. The parameter c is not required for the derivation. It can be seen that delta y is a positive value and minus delta x is a negative value. Now we look at the two cases and estimate the difference of two subsequent values of the decision variable d. We start with di larger than 0. In this case, we consider the difference delta northeast and compute it as the difference di plus 1 minus di. When we compute and simplify the difference, we end up with delta y minus delta x. As the slope of the line is between 0 and 1, delta x is larger than delta y, and delta northeast is a negative value. In the second case, di is smaller or equal to 0. As we move east in this case, we call the respective difference delta east. Again, delta east is computed as the difference of the subsequent decision variables di plus 1 and di, and in this case, the difference simplifies to delta y. So let's sum up. If our decision variable di is positive, we move northeast and add the negative value delta northeast to di to get di plus 1. If the decision variable di is negative, we move east and add the positive value delta east to di to get di plus 1. That's the implementation of the Bresenham line concept. In the initialization, the decision variable has to be computed once. We start with the first fragment pb at position xb, yb and compute the decision variable d1 as indicated on the slide. The respective term can be simplified to delta y minus 0.5 delta x. Now, in order to avoid floating point arithmetic, all computations are typically multiplied by 2. This is motivated by the fact that the concept works for any function alpha times f, with alpha being an arbitrary positive coefficient. When we evaluate f at a position xy, we are just interested in the sine of f, not in the actual value. That's why we can, for instance, work with 2 times f instead of f. Now for 2 times f, the initial value d1 is twice as big as for f, and also the differences delta east and delta northeast are twice as big as for f, as shown on the slide. These computations have the advantage that all terms are integers. Here we see an implementation of the Bresenham algorithm for line segments. Dx and dy are the x and y components of the vector from the start to the end vertex of the line segment. D is the first value of the decision variable. Increment east and increment northeast are the incremental updates of the decision variable depending on whether we move east or northeast. XY is the first fragment of the line segment initialized with XBYB, the position of the start vertex of the line segment. Now we generate a fragment at position XI and enter the main loop. As long as the X component of a fragment has not reached the X component of the end vertex, we increment the X component by 1. In order to decide what to do with the Y component, we check the sign of the decision variable. If the decision variable is smaller or equal to 0, we move east. In this case, the Y component does not change and the decision variable is updated with increment east. If the decision variable is positive, we move northeast. Here the Y component is incremented by 1 and the decision variable is updated with increment northeast. Finally, a fragment is generated for the new position XY. Again, we can see that we generate one fragment for each X value between XB and XE. And for the Y component, we decide whether to increment by 1 or not. This is the implementation for line segments with a slope between 0 and 1. All other slopes can be realized by employing symmetries. For instance, if the slope is between 0 and minus 1, then the Y component would not be incremented but decremented by 1. Another important type of primitives that we would like to rasterize are polygons. Here I do not go into details, but I'd like to outline the general idea. The illustration shows a polygon with 5 edges, and the goal of the rasterization process is the estimation of all yellow pixel positions that approximately represent the polygon. Polygon rasterization works for closed polygons. This means for each point in the plane of the polygon, we can decide whether we are inside or outside. This is intuitively clear. If we had, for instance, 3 line segments that are U-shaped and not closed, it would not be possible to distinguish inside and outside. So polygons need to be closed. Now the idea is to compute intersections of horizontal scan lines with all non-horizontal polygon edges. Such a horizontal scan line starts outside a polygon. After the first intersection with a polygon edge, we are inside the polygon. After the next intersection, we are outside the polygon, and so on. This idea works as long as the polygon is closed. So at each intersection of a horizontal scan line with a non-horizontal polygon edge, the inside-outside state of the scan line changes. And now, for all pixel positions on the scan line inside the polygon, we generate a fragment. In other words, we generate fragments at all pixel positions in between 2 intersections of the scan line with the polygon edges. In implementations, the scan line is generally slightly shifted, as indicated here. This approach is required for an appropriate rasterization of polygon meshes. Let's assume we have a surface that is represented with 6 triangles, and all triangles share one common vertex. In this case, the rasterizer has to ensure that exactly one fragment is generated at the vertex. The rasterizer should not miss the vertex, but it should also not generate more than one fragment at the same position. That's why we end up with a slightly shifted fragment pattern as shown in the illustration. Here on this slide, I'd like to outline one option to implement a polygon rasterizer. We start with a polygon and initially all pixel positions are marked as outside. Now we take a first edge of the polygon, compute the intersections with all horizontal scan lines and invert all pixel positions on the right-hand side of the intersections. We repeat this process for all non-horizontal edges of the polygon. Here we consider a second edge and invert the classification of all pixel positions on the right-hand side of an intersection with a horizontal scan line. We also do this for the third and the fourth edge of the polygon, but we do not have to process the horizontal edge. Finally, we end up with a correct classification of all pixel positions. Again, this concept works if the polygon is closed and if our scan line starts outside the polygon. Then we know that we are inside the polygon after the first intersection, outside the polygon after the next intersection, and so on. In the previous slides, I have discussed how to generate fragments that represent a line segment or a polygon. Now in the following, I'd like to discuss some aspects on how to interpolate attributes from vertices of a line segment or polygon to the fragments of the respective primitive. There's a general need to interpolate attributes from vertices to fragments. For instance, depth values have to be interpolated from vertices to fragments. Also, colors and texture coordinates are often interpolated. In many cases, we want to realize a linear interpolation. This sounds simple, but can be slightly involved due to the different coordinate systems that we work in. Typically, we would like to linearly interpolate in global or view space, but the interpolation is implemented in the rasterization stage, where all primitives are in clip space. Now it turns out that linear interpolation in view space cannot be generally realized as a linear interpolation in clip space. The issue and the solution are indicated here in this slide. We have a line with three points A, B, C in view space, and we consider an attribute I. We have I1 at position A and I2 at position B. Linear interpolation of this attribute at position C can be computed as I1 plus T times I2 minus I1, where T ranges from 0 to 1 and represents the relative position of C between A and B. Now we consider a perspective projection of the line, where we get the points A, B, C in clip space. It turns out that the ratio of S to 1 minus S in clip space is different to the ratio of T to 1 minus T in view space. This, by the way, also means that a perspective projection is not an affine transformation. In order to realize the linear interpolation in view space, a non-linear interpolation is required in clip space, as indicated here on the slide. Now, this non-linear interpolation can be expressed with two linear interpolations. We linearly interpolate I divided by Z in clip space, and we linearly interpolate 1 divided by Z in clip space. There's still a problem in the computation, namely the Z value. We have to perform the interpolation in clip space, so we do not have access to the Z component in view space. How to resolve this issue is indicated on the next slide. So in order to implement the interpolation in clip space, we need to know the Z value of a vertex in view space. Now the perspective projection, the transformation from view to clip space, is shown here in matrix form. The XYZ components of a vertex in view space are transformed to XYZ components in clip space. Interestingly, the Z component in view space can still be recovered from the transformation result. When we look at the computation of the W component in clip space, we see that W is just equal to the Z component in view space. So W clip is equal to Z view. This property is actually one reason to distinguish clip and NDC space. Instead of dividing all components in clip space by W clip to end up in NDC space, it can be useful to stay in clip space because the W component in clip space encodes the Z component from view space. As discussed on the previous slide, we would like to realize a linear interpolation of I divided by Z and a linear interpolation of 1 divided by Z in order to realize the interpolation of I in clip space that corresponds to a linear interpolation in view space. Now, in order to implement the interpolations of I divided by Z and 1 divided by Z, we cannot use Z from view space, but we know that Z view is equal to W clip, and that's why we can replace Z from view space with W from clip space, as indicated here. So if you would like to realize a perspective correct linear interpolation in case of a perspective projection, we store I divided by W and 1 divided by W at the vertices. Then we linearly interpolate these quantities and divide one by the other. That's it about the rasterization stage. We have seen how to rasterize line segments with the Bresnahan algorithm and the concept how to rasterize closed polygons. We also discussed issues and a solution in the context of perspective correct linear interpolations of attributes from vertices to fragments. At the end of the rasterization stage, we have fragments with attributes. Now I discuss the processing of these fragments in the fragment processing stage. Here we have an illustration of the embedding of the fragment processing stage into the rendering pipeline. From vertices with attributes and connectivity information, the rasterizer generates a set of fragments with interpolated attributes. These fragments do not necessarily contribute to the final image. They are candidates. Now the fragment processing stage processes the fragment attributes, and it also performs tests and decides whether to discard some fragments. The processed attributes of the remaining fragments are then used to update the attributes of pixels in the frame buffer. The tasks of the fragment stage are summarized on this slide. One task is the processing of fragment attributes. Another task is the testing of fragment attributes. Based on the outcome of such a test, a fragment can either be discarded if the test fails, or a fragment can pass a test. If it passes a test, its attributes are used in the frame buffer update. Now the processing and the testing make use of various data. First of all, the attributes of a fragment can be used. This can be its position, color, depth value, or texture coordinates. In addition to its own attributes, a fragment can also access textures, which are additional information of arbitrary dimensions. For various purposes, 2D textures are very popular, but 0D, 1D, 3D, and so on can be used as well. The fragment processing and testing can also use data from the frame buffer. We remember that the frame buffer is a 2D array of pixels, and at each pixel we can store attributes. These attributes are organized in buffers, such as the depth buffer, color buffer, stencil buffer, or accumulation buffer. Now a fragment in the fragment processing stage can use frame buffer attributes at the position of the fragment. Each fragment is characterized by a position, and the frame buffer data at this position can be used in the fragment processing and testing. These aspects are visualized here in this slide. On the left-hand side, we have the rasterizer that gets vertices with attributes and connectivity information. After the rasterization, we have fragments with attributes. Now the fragment stage works on the fragments and uses information from the fragments, from textures, and from the frame buffer. All this information is combined to process the attributes and to select the fragments whose attributes can be used to update the frame buffer. Here I'd like to give a brief overview of possible ways to process fragment attributes, and then we look into one example. One prominent example of the attribute processing is texturing. Here a fragment looks up additional data from a texture and uses this data to adapt one of its attributes, for instance the color. In the simplest case, texture data can just replace the color of a fragment, or the texture data can be interpreted as the material reflectance and then be used in the computation of the Phong elimination model at a fragment. Another option would be the realization of fog. In the discussion of shading concepts, I have already shown that fog effects can be realized by using the color of a fragment, the distance of the fragment to the sensor, and a fog color. As this information is available at each fragment in the fragment processing stage, the fog effect can be realized as a simple processing of fragment attributes. The last example that I'd like to mention is anti-aliasing. In order to minimize, for instance, staircase effects that occur in the rasterization of primitives, the alpha value of fragments can be adapted to smooth a line segment or to smooth the edges of a triangle. One of the most prominent examples of fragment processing is texturing. Texturing is often used to pretend detail in a rendered image. In order to be fast in the rendering, we typically try to minimize the number of triangles in a scene, but on the other hand, the image should look as detailed as possible. That's why detailed high-resolution textures are combined with coarsely triangulated surfaces. This concept is illustrated here. On the left-hand side, we see a texture, in this case 2D data, that contains images. On the right-hand side, we see a textured scene, which means that the texture has been considered in the rendering of the scene. We see one exemplary triangle, and we also see the part of the texture that is mapped to that triangle. So we would like to keep the number of triangles small, and in order to pretend detail, we establish a mapping from each triangle of a scene into a texture. Here we see how to use texture data in the fragment stage. We start with a triangle. Each vertex has two texture coordinates, u and v. These values typically range from 0 to 1 and describe a relative position in a 2D texture. In the rasterization stage, the texture coordinates are linearly interpolated from the vertices to the fragments. So in the fragment stage, we have texture coordinates UF and VF available at each fragment. In the texturing process, these coordinates are used to look up a value D at the position UF, VF in the texture. This value D can now be used in the processing of the fragment. As indicated in the previous slide, textures can contain colors, but they can actually also contain arbitrary information that might be useful for the processing of any of the attributes at a fragment. The second aspect of the fragment stage are tests. I briefly introduce a few examples and then I discuss some details of one of the most important or most prominent tests. A first example of a fragment test would be the Skizzer test. Here one can check whether a fragment position is inside a user-defined area. If the fragment is outside, it is discarded and not considered in further processes. A second example is the alpha test. I have already mentioned that the force component in a color vector is often referred to as alpha value and that this value can be used to render transparent surfaces. Now in the fragment stage, the alpha value can be compared to a user-defined value and based on the outcome, a fragment can be discarded. Another interesting test is the stencil test. The so-called stencil is just a scalar value, a number. This value is not stored at a fragment, but in the frame buffer. Nevertheless, a fragment can access the stencil value in the frame buffer at its position. The stencil buffer is, for instance, used in shadow algorithms, such as shadow volumes. The most prominent test for fragments is certainly the depth test. The depth test is used to resolve visibility. If more than one fragment is generated at the same pixel position, the depth test ensures that only the closest fragment is visible in the rendering result. Therefore, the depth test compares two depth values, namely the depth value stored at the fragment and the depth value stored in the frame buffer at the position of the fragment. If the fragment depth value is larger than the frame buffer depth value, then the fragment is occluded by a previously rendered fragment and the fragment is discarded. If the fragment depth value is smaller than the frame buffer depth value, the fragment is closer than previously rendered fragments. In this case, the fragment passes and its attributes replace the current color and depth values in the frame buffer. This concept is illustrated here for an example with two triangles. Initially, all depth values in the frame buffer are set to infinity. Now the first triangle is rasterized and the illustration shows the depth values of all fragments. Here all fragments have the same depth value of 5. For each of these fragments, we compare its depth value with the depth value in the frame buffer at the position of the fragment. In all cases, 5 is smaller than infinity and the attributes of the fragments replace previously stored information in the frame buffer. So the depth values at the respective positions are set to 5 and the colors are set to gray. This frame buffer is the starting point for the second triangle. The green triangle gets rasterized and here we get depth values with a range from 2 to 7. Now the depth value of each fragment is compared to the depth value of the frame buffer at the position of the fragment. If the depth value of a fragment of the green triangle is larger than the depth value in the frame buffer, then the fragment is occluded and will be discarded. It does not contribute to the final image. Only if the depth value of a fragment is smaller than the depth value in the frame buffer, then the fragment attributes replace the information in the frame buffer. So green fragments are partially discarded and partially rendered to get the final result that corresponds to the scene setup shown on the left-hand side. Please note that the result does not depend on the processing order of the primitives or the fragments. So you can basically process all primitives and fragments in an arbitrary order to get the same result. That's it about the fragment processing stage. I've discussed some processing examples and some tests. In terms of the processing, we have looked into texturing, and in terms of tests, I have discussed the concept of the depth test. Now we briefly look into the frame buffer update. We have already seen an example of a frame buffer update in combination with the depth test, where depth values and colors of fragments have been used to update the depth buffer and the color buffer. Now in the following, I'd like to discuss one additional interesting option for the frame buffer update. In combination with the depth test, we have seen that fragment attributes can replace frame buffer values. Now fragment attributes and frame buffer values can also be combined, which is referred to as blending and illustrated here for colors. We consider a fragment at position X fragment with color C fragment. Now this color can be linearly combined with the frame buffer color C frame buffer at the position X fragment, for instance based on the alpha value of a fragment. The setting is also illustrated. We have the fragment with its attributes position, color and alpha value. And we have the frame buffer, where a color might be stored at the position of the fragment. Now these two colors can be interpolated based on the alpha value as indicated in the equation. The resulting color replaces the color in the frame buffer. So if the alpha value of a fragment is 1, then the color of the fragment replaces the color in the frame buffer at the position of the fragment. If the alpha value is 0, then the frame buffer color does not change. If alpha is in between 0 and 1, then the frame buffer color is replaced by a mixture of the frame buffer color and the fragment color. Blending can actually be used to render semi-transparent surfaces. If you render a semi-transparent surface in front of an opaque surface, then you would first render the opaque surface and then the semi-transparent surface. When rendering the semi-transparent surface, the colors of the opaque surface and the semi-transparent surface could be mixed or blended. That's it about rasterization-based rendering. We have seen that rasterization in combination with the depth test can be used to resolve visibility. So it is an alternative to raycasting. We have also seen that rasterization-based renderers are often implemented in the so-called rendering pipeline. The organization of the rendering pipeline is motivated by parallelism. In one stage, all vertices are processed independently. In another stage, all fragments are processed independently. We have also discussed the rasterization concept, in particular for line segments and polygons. The rendering pipeline consists of stages. First, vertices are transformed, typically from the local coordinate system to clip space. Attributes can be set or computed at vertices. The rasterization stage gets vertices with topology information and generates fragments. Attributes are transferred from vertices to fragments. Then fragment attributes are processed, tests are performed, and some fragments might be discarded. The attributes of the remaining fragments are used to update the frame buffer. The frame buffer consists of various buffers, where one buffer stores colors which represent the final rendering result. Thanks for your attention.